How's everybody doing this morning? We are so glad that you are here. We are so excited to worship with you this morning. Why don't you guys stand up, say hello to somebody around you, and we're going to go to God and worship.
Sing a little louder. take us back, the place we began, a simple pursuit of nothing but you. The innocence of a heart in your head. God, take us back. God, take us back to unswerving faith. Power of the name, a heart beating for kingdom to reign, a church that is known for your presence again. God, take us back. Nothing and no one comes close to you. Nothing could ever come close. Nothing and no one. It's you and you only. Nothing could ever come close. Keep our hearts here. Keep your grace close. You're bringing us back. Unswerving faith in the power of the name, a heart beating for your kingdom to reign, a church that is known for your presence again.
Nothing can ever come close to you. 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 Nothing can Good morning. Man, worship is so strong this morning. I'm so excited to be in the house. And because I'm super spiritual, I woke up this morning and got on Instagram first thing. And I read this from one of the worship leaders that I follow. I've never met him, but he said this: I woke up this morning convinced once again that God deserves my very best, so I'm going to give it to him. I may not feel like it, but thanks be to God that his steadfastness and faithfulness to me is not predicated on whims or emotion, but on his unchanging nature. So I'm breaking free this morning. And then he said, churchgoers, go ahead and worship God. Give him your very best. But I guess the question that I have after a song like that, that I think all of us should maybe reflect on, is why? Why would we sing over and over and over again that nothing and no one comes close to you? And I seriously want you to think about that this morning. Whether you've been going to church for a long time, whether you're brand new, why do we believe words like that? And maybe even if you're not a churchgoer and you're brand new to this place, you'd be like, well, we say that for a lot of reasons. Like, if what we've heard about Jesus is true, we say nothing and no one comes close to him because, not just for one reason, but he's gracious and he's kind and he's patient and he's slow to anger and abounding in love. And then on the other side of the spectrum, he's holy and he's majestic and he's awesome and he's further than our imagination and he's beyond comprehension. There are so many different things. There are so many different reasons why we would sing, why we would give him our very best, why we would sing nothing and no one even comes close to you. He's that good. But I guess my challenge and my charge and the question that I want to ask this morning, is there one reason, like is there one overarching reason this morning why we would worship, why we would sing? And I started thinking this morning about all those characteristics as to why we would sing those lyrics. And I believe that all of them are seen. All of them are displayed. All of them are put in our view and in our gaze at the cross. At the most beautiful event in history 2,000 years ago, where the love of God and the grace of God and the mercy of God meets the justice of God and the holiness of God and the perfection of God. Right there, 2,000 years ago. The reason I believe that we sing this morning is because Jesus, who being in very nature God, Philippians 2, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. And I just want to invite you for a moment before we sing this next song, if you'd be so willing, just to close your eyes. Think about that with me. Reflect on that event with me, where the grace of God and the justice of God meet. Together, as we close our eyes, let's think about the beatings. Let's think about our Savior being struck continually by Roman guards. Let's think about him being handed over to the authorities. Let's think about him being clothed with a robe in mockery of who he is, crowned with a crown of thorns. People mocked him, said, "Oh, you're the king of the Jews, huh?" Think about those who spat upon him. Think about his wrists and his feet being nailed to a first century torture tool. And think about the humbling fact that our sin did this to him. My sin did this to him. Your sin did this to him. Think about the fact that 2,000 years ago, while Jesus is hanging on a cross, that he bore our punishment, that he bore our sin, that he bore our shame, to the point where he cries, "Father, why have you forsaken me?" This pain, this punishment that he is bearing on our behalf is beyond our wildest imagination. and think about the fact that while our sin did this to him, Jesus did this for you. Jesus did this for me. Jesus willingly went to the cross so that you could be forgiven, so that you could be free. And when he cries, "It is finished," it's not metaphorical, it's not poetic. He is saying, "It really is finished." And now all who will believe, their shame is gone. Their death has been defeated. Their penalty has been paid. It's been paid in full. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name. We sing today because he's worthy, and he's worthy because he was the lamb that was slain. Think about your response. What should our response be this morning? If Jesus really died, if Jesus really rose, defeating death and hell and everything that the enemy held in his hand, how loud should our voices get this morning? How high should our hands reach this morning? Father, we love you, and we're grateful for you, for what Jesus has done for all of us. And Father, I just pray that over the next few minutes, last song that we sing this morning before the message, that all of us could really, really, really give our all to you because you're worthy of it. Father, I pray that we can thank you. I mean, we can really thank you for what you did for us on the cross. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
The life you gave, your body was broken, your love poured out, you bled and you died for me there on the cross. You breathed your last as you were crucified. You gave it all for me, yeah. Savior, hallelujah, what a friend, hallelujah, King forever, we thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross.
white as snow. No, I sins I sky laid. You have made us white as snow.
Would you guys just take a minute to go to God on your own? Give him your praise. Give him your love. Give him your worries. Give him your doubts. Give him anything that's on your heart right now. Father, we thank you for the cross. Whether we know it or not, it's why we're here this morning. We thank you for that. Would you help us see the truth in that more and more this morning as we seek you, Lord? Help us understand where we really were before that, how hopeless we really were before you took the sin and shame of the world. Would you help us see the pain that you went through, beyond the physical, because there's been people here on earth that have gone through crucifixion, but beyond the physical, you took each and every sin and evil deed that happened throughout this history of humanity, and you took it upon yourself. You took our shame, you took our guilt, and you paid it in full. Father, would you help us understand that more? Would you help us see you more clearly this morning? Father, wherever we are on our spiritual journey this morning, would you meet us where we're at? And we thank you so much that I know that that's going to be true, that is true, that you've met each and every one of us where we are, and that whether we're aware of it or not, you're working in our lives. But Father, we thank you. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. You guys can take a seat.
All right. Well, it's good to be here this morning. My name's Josh. I'm one of the pastors here at Oak Bridge. And
my name's Kelsey.
Yeah. And we have some announcements, right?
Yeah. So, hey, if you've never been to either Oak Bridge location, either this one or Arnold, we have a few announcements for our first-time guests. First off, we have a room downstairs. It's called the Connect Room. It's designed just for you. We want to meet you. We want to say hi, get to know you a little bit, and then also give you some free T-shirts. So if you've never done that, make sure you stop by there right after service. And then also just a few things you'll notice. There's no offering in service. That's by design. We ask that you not give and let this service be our gift to you. But if you call Oak Bridge your home, if you believe in our mission, which is to make followers of Jesus who in turn make followers of Jesus, then you know where the joy boxes are out, where the joy boxes are at, outside in the foyer in the main lobby. And then lastly, no communion in service, but there is communion available in a room called the Reflection Room. That's right down the hallway to the right.
Awesome. And then we have something tonight, correct?
More news, yes. Yeah. We have the Edge tonight.
Yes, exciting.
Just super exciting. The Edge is our student services on Sunday nights. It's actually at our Arnold location. So tonight at 6, we're in the middle of a really cool series called Normal Isn't Working. So if you have a student middle school through high school, we would encourage you to go check that out. Or if you have a middle school or high schooler student and you attend Oak Bridge City, we're having a luncheon right after church with Josh just to answer some questions and talk a little bit.
Yeah. So we'd love to have you right after church. We'll just have a conversation and try and plan a little bit on what we're going to do moving forward for your students. And we have a golf tournament coming up on October 5th. We are super excited about that. And so if you don't have a foursome, we would love for you to sign up. So go to the information center and sign up for that. It's the desk right outside in the lobby, and we really would love for you to sign up. It's a great tournament. I know what some of you are thinking. Don't worry. There's a B flight. There's a C flight, so you aren't just playing for second place. It's going to be really, really good. No, I'm just kidding. I've never won before, but this year is our year. But yeah, so we're really looking forward to it. All the proceeds go to Next Generation Ministries here, and it's really been kind of a fun event for the last couple years. It really has, and we've had around 36 to 40 foursomes, I believe, the last couple years. A bunch of guys, women as well. Great opportunity to connect with one another, and so we'd love for you to sign up for that. And then lastly, the day after the golf tournament, it's going to be an extraordinary weekend.
Yes.
October 6th, I believe, is the date. And correct me if I'm wrong on that. It's the date, right?
Not a clue.
Okay, cool. October 6th. I think it's on your brochure, but actually I know it is. It's the right date. I'm second guessing myself up here. It's the Explore Oak Bridge Luncheon. And so we really want you to sign up for this, okay? Like we really, really do. We can't stress this enough. So if you're kind of new to Oak Bridge City, if you're kind of new to the church and you aren't necessarily sure who we are, what we're doing, who's this guy up here, looks a little different. We're brand new to all this whole Christianity thing, this whole church thing, or maybe you're coming from a different church and you're just like, I want to know a little more about it. This is the time for you to come and ask literally any question you want, okay? So you can come ask any question you want about kind of the setup, the structure, how we do things, why we do things, what we believe here, some of the core values, how those things play themselves out here at Oak Bridge City. And so please come to that. We'll have a lunch provided for you right after church down in the cafe. You can sign up online or downstairs in the Connect Room. And so we would love for you to do that. You have anything else for us?
Yes, I do. Why did the hipster burn his mouth when he was eating pizza?
No clue.
He ate it before it was cool.
It's a good one. I've been at Arnold the last couple weeks, and I just have really missed that. I really have. Sundays have been incomplete. With that said, I'm going to say a prayer for us, and we're going to continue on in our series titled Monsters. Father, we love you and are really grateful for the opportunity to know you, to hear from you, and I pray that that can take place in the next 30 or so minutes. There's something extraordinary that could potentially happen every time we open your word. Every time we think about your word, it's alive and it's active and it's sharper than any double-edged sword, and it convicts and it digs down deep into the innermost parts of who we are. And so, Father, I pray that your word does what only your word can do in the next 30 or 35 minutes. I pray that this isn't about, you know, just a cool presentation or an educational experience, but I really do pray that we can meet with the creator of the universe over the next few moments together. Whether we're brand new, whether we've been in church for a long time, I pray that you ignite in us something that you need to ignite. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Everybody said, amen.
How y'all doing today? Doing all right? So, yep. Today, I mean, we have never had the tech people not show up for a Sunday service. We've never had the band not show up. And just so you know, the band, they had to redo everything late last night. One of the drummer, Dan, got sick and couldn't be here. So, you know, just today, as you go around the building, just remember there's a lot of people that are faithful and show up every single week. Just give them a thank you later on today, all right? So. But I've enjoyed this series that we're in, the Monster series, you know, things that we're addressing that could be really detrimental to our faith. And Josh talked about legalism a couple weeks ago. Last week he talked about idolatry. And today I'm going to talk about worldliness. And he mentioned a passage of scripture Josh did last week from Colossians that I want to start with and read again. This is from Colossians 1. Kind of sets the stage for everything we're going to be talking about today. But it says, "The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created. In Jesus all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him." I mean, think about that. Jesus is the creator of all. Jesus is the one that sits on the throne. He started it. He sustains it. He watches over it. And the older I get, the more I'm amazed at his creation. I look around and I watch TV shows and I just marvel at his handiwork. Sometimes when I open our front door, we've got some flowers on our porch and a little hummingbird has been around, and it just kind of amazes me. We've got a backyard bird feeder that I love watching when the birds are up there. And again, I guess maybe I'm getting old, but I like watching the squirrels and the rabbits. And it just all reminds me of the goodness that God declared upon his creation way back in the beginning of the Bible in chapters 1 and 2 of Genesis. He creates everything. And he says, it is good. He pronounces his pleasing, you know, just that what he had done was well and good. And then I've got a couple dogs, Charlie and Izzy, and they're a constant reminder to me of Genesis 3. And Genesis 3 records the fall and how sin and chaos totally entered the world, right? And then they kind of just keep that going. But you know, seriously, there is nothing outside of God's notice. Nothing. He's created this world with incredible wisdom, with incredible precision, with incredible variety. I mean, we are still discovering new species of animals. We are finding out new, minute scientific details. The vastness of outer space is even growing. Just all amazing. And again, I just think, it's Jesus that created all. What wisdom, what intellect, what power. It's no wonder that 4,000 years ago, nearly 4,000 years ago, a man named Job said these words. He said, "Ask the animals and they will teach you, or the birds in the sky and they will tell you, or speak to the earth and it will teach you, or let the fish in the sea inform you. Which of all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this? In his hand is the life of every creature and the breath of all mankind." Right? Jesus sits on the throne. He's the one that did it all. And it's amazing. The creation points to an amazing creator. So today's topic's a little heavy. Hopefully might be convicting. Hopefully it leads us to change. But I want to have a little fun first and just just bathe in God's creation a little bit. So we're going to show some slides up here, and I want you to find the animal that's hidden in that picture. Anybody look in there, see it? We'll go ahead and you'll catch on. Go ahead. There's giraffe. See that? Just amazing. All right. Let's go on. Find the animal in this one. Good luck. All right. See it down there? Okay. A little kind of rodent. All right, let's move on to the next one. All right. Where is it? Let's show, there's the lizard. Just right, you know, just it's called a leaf lizard. I mean, come on. All right? Let's move on. See anything in there? Right in the middle, snake. Okay. That ought to be scary when we're walking out in the woods, these camouflage things. Let's go on. How about this one? See anything in that picture? Yeah, big old cat down there in the bottom. All right. How about this one freaks me out. You can move on. That's a moth sitting up on a tree limb. I mean, just, again, God's handiwork, amazing. Go on. Okay, there we go. All right, an owl sitting there. Yeah, an owl in the middle of it. And then I guess we see that one. Ugh, right? Yeah, a big old spider there. All right. And I think we have the last one here. Anybody see? You got a hawk that fits into there. So again, those pictures, they kind of freak me out. You see why I'm wearing the camouflage shirt, Ashley Altman? You made fun of me? Here we go. All right? So, but God's creation is good. He loves it. He protects it. He watches over it. And as we just saw, he's amazingly equipped the animal kingdom for survival. Right? And again, just think of what we've talked about already just this morning. That God, the wisdom, the creativity, the intellect, just the planning that all that took, because we'll come back to this. But what I'm even maybe more amazed about than all the thousands of different animals and how he's put them in their special place is that God has a special place in his heart for his people, for the church. As a matter of fact, one of the main metaphors that God uses for his relationship with the church is marriage. Jesus says that he's the bridegroom. And that we're the beloved bride. The church is the beloved bride. And he's jealous for his people. And he's jealous for them in a healthy way. He wants nothing to come between him and his bride. He fights for his bride. He watches over his bride. He protects his bride. But his plan for his church, his plan for his people, is different than what we saw is his plan for those animals. See, most animals, they survive and they thrive by blending into their surroundings. But for the bride of Christ, for Jesus' followers, for the church to thrive, God tells us he doesn't want us to camouflage ourselves. Instead, he wants us to stick out. He wants us to go against the grain. He wants to be separate from. Jesus said it this way in Matthew chapter 5. He says, "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden, and neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house." In the same way, Jesus says, "Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deed and bring praise and glorify your Father in heaven." And then the Apostle Paul in Philippians, he says he wants the church, he wants God's people to do everything without grumbling or complaining so that they shine like stars in the universe. So see, basically the message that God's given us is he says, I want your attitudes, Your relationships, your values, your demeanor, your morality. He says, your life is my bride, is my people. I want it to be different than the norm. In other words, the gospel message says this to us. The good news of Jesus says that God has chosen you. Jesus says, I've chosen you. God says, I've ransomed you, and it came with an enormous cost. It cost the life of my son. He died on a cross because he loves you deeply. Jesus says that I have called you from death to life. I've called you from darkness to light. He says, you've been born again. I've replaced your heart of stone with a heart of flesh. He says, I've empowered you. I've sealed you with the Holy Spirit. Because of the work of my son Jesus, he says that I have declared you righteous and unblemished. He says, I've sent the Spirit to commune with you, to reside in you. He says, I am working in your life every single day. I'm working on you to make you in practicality what you are positionally. He says, you are declared righteous, and I've set you apart to bring me glory and honor. You are being transformed. You're being transformed. Here's the deal. Jesus says, I've done all that for you, and I want the world to see it. See, I want you to shine, not because you're better than anybody, not because out of some arrogant way, but I want you to shine so that people will take notice and you can humbly give all the credit to me. And again, this does not mean at all that we're perfect. It doesn't mean that you will not sin, but it does mean that if you follow Jesus, if you accepted him into your life, that a transformation should be taking place in your life over time. And God is doing the work, and people should notice that. And again, we give him the glory and credit and honor. That's God's plan for his bride, for the church, for Jesus' followers. So Josh is kind of focused on a couple of letters. One was to a city in Galatia where he talked about legalism. Then last week to a letter to a church in Colossae where he talked about idolatry. And this morning we're going to focus on a letter that Paul wrote to believers in a city called Corinth. And Corinth was a major metropolitan city. It was a seaport and a major trade center in Paul's day. It was probably the most important city in that area, right? It wasn't very far from Athens, Greece. And Paul had founded and established a church there 5 years prior to writing this letter to these people. And the city was filled with immorality and idolatry. I mean, it was a cosmopolitan kind of hip city. But many people had come out of this pagan culture, and they'd come to believe in and to follow Jesus. But the people in this church, they were struggling with their environment. They were surrounded by corruption and every conceivable sin, and they were feeling the pressure to adapt to their surroundings. Much like the animals that we saw, the people of Christ in this town were starting to blend in with the culture around them. And to their credit, they had a lot of questions that they needed answered. They knew that they had freedom in Christ, but they wondered, how is this going to play out in my everyday life? How should we view the idols around us that Josh talked about last week? There's all kinds of views in their culture about sex. And so how should the church view sexuality? What's its place? What about marriage? What about order and worship? How are they supposed to resolve disputes among them, to resolve problems? They had lots of questions for Paul. And these weren't just theoretical questions. The existence and the effectiveness of the church, it was really being undermined by the immorality and the spiritual immaturity and the worldliness of many of these Corinthian Christians. And the church was asking for guidance. They said, Paul, we need you to explain some things to us. So this is Paul's answer to some of their questions in the book, in the letter that we call 1 Corinthians. And it's a letter that was relevant to these people 2,000 years ago. But I think it's one that pegs many of the situations that we find in our environment today here in the United States. See, I think the church in the States today is confused. And I would guess that our culture is not much different from Corinth. And many here today, we know that we have freedom in Christ. But again, how does that play out in our 21st century lives? See, we're bombarded with ideas and beliefs and worldviews that are totally opposite of what Jesus came and taught. We see it on our television shows, in our movies, on the internet, our entertainment and art world, what we're taught a lot of times in universities and schools, maybe even in our own homes. And see, it's easy to merge with our surroundings. And basically, the message that the world gives out is this. It's all about me. It's I. As Josh talked about last week, really what the world says is, I want you to put yourself on the throne. That's the key to happiness. That's the key to life. I deserve this. Nobody's going to tell me what to do. And all too often, The church, I think, even today buys into that. And we don't look much different than the pagan culture around us. So here's how Paul opens the letter. And he opens a lot of his letters to the churches in similar fashion. I love this. He brings them right back to Jesus. This is what he says in 1 Corinthians 1. It says, Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and our brother Sosthenes, to the church of God in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus and called to be his holy people, together with all those everywhere who call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, their Lord and ours. So in other words, right off the bat, he reminds them of who they are in Christ. He says, you've been called out. You've been sanctified, which means you're set apart for God's purposes. He says, you are a holy people. Again, a word that just means set apart. And then he goes on and he reminds them, right, that Jesus is their Lord. That Jesus is their Lord and not just, you know, a friend and not just a savior, but the master, the boss, the ruler of the universe. The one that we talked about that set all this in motion. So Jesus has to be the one that sits on the throne. That's what he talks about. And then he goes on. He says, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I always thank my God for you because of his grace given you in Christ Jesus. For in him you have been enriched in every way with all kinds of speech and with all knowledge. God thus confirming our testimony about Christ among you. Therefore, you do not lack any spiritual gift as you eagerly wait for our Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. He will also keep you firm to the end so that you will be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, who has called you into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Again, he reminds them of what they have in Jesus. He says, this is what Jesus did for you. He called you out. He saved you. Then this is what he's doing for you. He's equipped you. He's gifted you. He has blessed you. And then he reminds them that Jesus will be with them to the very end and complete the mission. Right? So he builds them up. He reaffirms their position in Christ. He reminds them of God's amazing grace and the blessings that he gives. And then he begins to tackle the issues, the sin issues, head on. And as I said, he talks about disunity and division and lawsuits and selfishness and disorder and sexual immorality. He sets the stage for who we are in Christ, what God has done for us, and then he begins to answer their questions. And we're going to get to that in just a minute, but as I was thinking through this, and Tom let us know about the series a month or two ago, and Josh and I have talked, and we've been thinking through some things, and for me, I really have questioned and thought about, why do we sin? Why do I sin? You know, why is it a problem? And I think one is sometimes we just fall to temptation, right? We don't flee. We don't do the things we should do. And there's this constant struggle that goes on. The Apostle Paul talked about it. We do the things we know we shouldn't do that we don't want to do. And I think, again, not an excuse, but it's just we're sinners. And we mess up and we fall even when we try and battle. And that's one, I think. But then again, I think sometimes, again, we just place ourselves on the throne. And it's all about us. And sure, we come to church on Sunday mornings and we say, God's for me. And we sing his praises and we proclaim his perfection. And we acknowledge his sacrifice on the cross and the love that he has for us. And we get pumped up when we sing about the resurrection. And I thought, you know, it's funny because that's an amazing message. Like a mind-boggling message. And we trust God, we trust Jesus for our eternal salvation, but then oftentimes we leave this place and we go out and we live life on our own terms. We say, he's my Savior, but he's not the Lord when it comes to my workplace or my Friday and Saturday nights or my bedroom. See, I'm going to trust him when it comes to heaven, but quite frankly, I think I know a little bit more about what's going to make me happy and what's going to satisfy and fulfill me in this life. So Jesus, I'll trust you for that really big thing, but here in the now, for everyday life, I don't really need you in the picture. And we put ourselves on the throne. And then I think sometimes we sin simply because we don't know any better. Right? Again, I think too many of us, we rely on these 75 minutes on Sunday morning. Tom will be coming back next week, so these 90 minutes on Sunday morning, right? And we're ignorant of God's word, and we don't read it, and our image of who Jesus is and what he desires for us and what he offers us isn't based upon the truth of God's word. And thus, our worldview, it's shaped by the things around us, by maybe how we were raised, what our friends think, what the media promotes, what our favorite celebrity says, right? Or what our teachers tell us. And we don't obey God because we don't even know his commands. In the Corinthian church, they had a sin problem. And again, Paul goes on and he addresses this in 1 Corinthians 3, and he says this, "Brothers and sisters, I couldn't address you as people who live by the Spirit, but as people who are still worldly, mere infants in Christ. He says, I gave you milk, but not solid food, for you weren't ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready." He says this, he says, you are still worldly, still worldly. I like to go out to eat. How many of you guys like to go out to eat? Like, yep. And I really like going out to eat with my family. We don't do it as much as we used to. There's 9 or 10 of us when we go out, and quite frankly, they don't order off the kids' menu anymore. So it gets really expensive, and now there's a new wrinkle, right? We've got our little 8-month-old grandson, Max, and when he comes, you never know what you're going to get. Is it nap time? Did he sleep well? Right? Is he hungry? You guys understand the deal, right? You try and time it right. You try and keep the little ones occupied. Maybe you give them a bottle or a sippy cup, or, you know, you just try and keep him going. And that's okay. I mean, he's a little kid, and that would be normal. But what if I went to dinner with my family, and I sat down at the table, and everybody else was ordering, but instead I pulled out a bottle and started, that is really warm milk, yuck. But that would be weird, wouldn't it? That looked weird. That's what Paul says. He says, you know what? It's time for you Christians to grow up. Quit sucking on a bottle. Quit being babies. In a book called Christian Atheists that I read parts of this week, it says, immature Christians are worldly. They're controlled by their own desires. But mature believers are in tune with God's desires. See, little kids say, me, 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 I want this, mine. Max is, like I said, 8 months old, and he can't talk yet, he can't even point yet, but he grunts, and when there's something he wants, he gets all excited. It's almost like he's getting ready to ride a motorcycle, you know, and gets all revved up, and he's kind of leads you in a direction somehow by his grunting and body movements, and it's cute sometimes, right? But it's normal for a little kid to do that, but it's not normal. Not healthy for a mature adult. And see, many of these Christians in Corinth, they were immature babies. And again, they trusted God for their eternal destinies. That was appealing to them. But they followed the crowd in their everyday lives. They'd become enticed by the world around them, and they had melded in to society. Probably 20 years ago, I was leading a small group of middle schoolers. And we were in my family room, and I don't even remember what we were studying, but I asked him a question. I said, guys, if you knew the minute that you were going to die, if somehow God let you in on that secret, and you knew when you were going to die, or maybe if he told you when Jesus was going to come back, but anyway, you knew when your life was going to be over in the present form, I said, would you choose to surrender your life and follow Jesus, you know, with that knowledge from this point on, living that way, or would you wait until like the day before you were going to die or Jesus was going to come back? Every single middle schooler said they'd wait till the day before. And it was sad to me, but unfortunately, I think it was indicative of the mindset of many people. See, we want eternal life because we think it's better than the alternative. But right now, we're allured, we're deceived by what the world offers. And too often, we choose worldliness over godliness, money, prestige, sexual pleasure, unhealthy party, and a pursuit of happiness above all, a happiness that the world promises but is fleeting and realistically leads to death. And see, if you're a Jesus follower in this room, today really should be asking your question of yourself this, and we all should. Do I stand out or do I blend in? In my surroundings, whether it's at work or at school or at home or in my neighborhood or if I'm just out and about, would anyone, my coworkers, my bosses, my subordinates, my classmates, my spouses, children, parents, neighbors, the people that I'm serving at my job, maybe the people that are serving me when I go out, would any of them have a clue that you're a Jesus follower by the attitudes and actions that you show? Are you camouflaged? Or are you a bright light? See, Paul makes it clear in this letter. It's a tough, tough topic. He makes it clear in this letter. He says, the people that are defined by these characteristics, these are things that are not to have anything to do with my kingdom. And he talks about sexual immorality. He talks about idolatry. He talks about cheating, about drunkenness, about slander, about gossip, about spreading falsehood, about shady business practices, about a lack of forgiveness, about this me-first attitude. He makes it clear that those things have no part and no place in God's kingdom. But then I love this, because again, he always brings it back to Jesus. He says, hey, brothers and sisters, you're in Christ. And he comes back in 1 Corinthians 6 and he says, that's what some of you were. After he listed all those characteristics, he says, that's what some of you were. That's what you were defined by. He says, but you were washed. You were sanctified. Jesus has called you out. He has set you apart for his purposes. You were justified, declared righteous in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. He says, come on, guys. It's time to grow up. The one that you follow has called you out of that stuff. Think about what you're doing. Remember what you have in Jesus. God is good. God is good. And see, the Corinthians, they'd mistaken their freedom in Christ for a license to sin. And Paul called them out. He said, you know, again, you think you're mature, you think you're grown up, and yet you wink at sin. You flirt with it. You're enticed by it. As a matter of fact, Paul mentioned a situation, a specific situation in that church that he said, it's not even heard of among the pagans. He pointed out and said that in the church, there was a man who was sleeping with his father's wife. So we don't know if it was his biological mother or if it was a stepmom. But Paul said, not only do you allow that to go on in your midst, he says, you don't point it out, you don't call it out. He says, you're even proud of it. You think you've moved so far ahead and that you're mature. He goes, the pagans would think that dreadful. See, again, they had melded with the culture around them. They were camouflaged. And the sexual immorality, and he spent a lot of time talking about it, had seemed to preside and was flourishing in the Corinthian church. And again, Paul addresses this worldliness, this mindset, by bringing them back to Jesus. In 1 Corinthians 6, he says this. He says, flee from sexual immorality. All other sins a person commits are outside the body, but whoever sins sexually sins against their own body. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. He says, remember who's the Lord. It's not you. It's the one who purchased you, the one that bought you. He's bought you. You are not your own. You are to surrender. That's what it means to follow Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit resides in you, and he wants his dwelling to be holy. And see, in our culture today, like the Corinthian church, we've taken God's amazing gift of sex and we've cheapened it. It's a gift from God that's meant to be enjoyed in the confines of marriage between a husband and wife. It's to show the oneness, in a metaphorical way, the oneness between a husband and a wife that Jesus has with his church. And we've distorted it and we've twisted it and we think it's the next step in our relationship. And we say, if it feels good, do it. And it's all about me, me, me. And it's wreaked havoc. Paul says that this is a sin that's in a different category. It does such damage to your soul. This is such a deeply spiritual act. You don't even know what you're messing with. And in today's church, we got a lot of confusion. A lot of ignorance when it comes to God's plan for sex and for marriage and for singleness. And I think this is a hugely relevant and important topic in the church today. And I don't have time to go into a lot of stuff, but I'm going to do a toolbox class on starting. It's going to be 2 weeks on October the 9th, on Wednesday night, and October the 16th. And we're going to talk about sexuality. And we're going to talk about marriage. And we're going to talk about singleness. And we're going to talk about all of those things that were confused in our culture, the hot topics that come up when we start talking about sex. And then on the 23rd, on the third week, we're going to have Katie Hagley is going to help me out. She leads our children's ministry, and she's been studying. And we're going to help parents how to talk to our kids and how to guide them in this direction when the world is giving so much confusing statements. And we're going to show them what God's plan is and how to talk to our kids about sex and guide them in God's way from toddlerhood all the way up to adulthood. And you can sign up for that online or out at the desk. But a big topic. And, you know, as I've been thinking about this message for several days, for a week or plus, and I thought originally I was going to come up and I was going to give a bunch of stats, and I thought that I would spend more time talking about sin. But then I listened to Josh's first two messages, and I read 1 Corinthians. And Paul boldly addresses sin. And he keeps bringing it up, and he calls out the worldliness and the immaturity of the church, and he's honest and he's stern and he's forthright, but it's cool. He always brings it back to Jesus. Most of the letter is about our Savior, about our Lord, about Jesus Christ. And I love the way that he ends the letter. He brings them all the way back, starts off with Jesus, has Jesus all throughout the letter, and ends it with Jesus. And he brings them back to the gospel message. He says, God loves you. Christ died for you. He was raised on the third day. He provides for you. And it says, one day he's coming back, and all this sin stuff is going to be eradicated, and all is going to be made new and perfect, and that includes you. And he says, Jesus is going to reign forever in your midst. So again, he brings us back to what we have in Christ and what's awaiting us in Christ. And we should look forward to that. Why would we want anything less now? So what are we to do? Right? As a church and as individuals, what are we to do to deal with this worldliness that can destroy our faith? Scholars believe that the Apostle Paul wrote at least four letters to this Corinthian church. So they were messed up, they were confused, and I love the fact that Paul didn't give up on them. He didn't kick them out. He didn't say that God's given up on you. He keeps bringing them back to our King and Lord and Savior. And this is what he wrote in 2 Corinthians. All right, and 2 Corinthians was a letter, and what he's addressing here is probably a situation that he had spoken about in one of the letters that we no longer have. And he had called sin out, and he had been bold and blunt, and this is what he says in 2 Corinthians 7. He says, even if I caused you sorrow by my letter, I don't regret it. Though I did regret it, I see that my letter hurt you, but only for a little while. Yet now I am happy, not because you were made sorry, but because your sorrow led you to repentance. For you became sorrowful as God intended, and so you were not harmed in any way by us. He says, godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret, but worldly sorrow brings death. So what do we do with our worldliness, with our sin? What we do is what Paul recommended, what Paul hoped would be happening in the Corinthian church. We repent. We repent. And again, I think some of us, if we've grown up in church, we think that, you know, repentance means a guy standing up in a pulpit and condemning and repent, and you got to change your ways. And that is not the idea of all. To repent means to turn around. In other words, I've been going life my own way in this direction. And you do a 180 and you head towards Jesus. You head back towards God. So you turn around. But it also starts in the mind. To repent means to change your mind, because our actions flow out of our beliefs. So that's why Paul continued to bring the church back to Jesus, continued to bring him back to the gospel message of who God is, what we have in him, what he's done for us. This past Monday night, I was up here. We have a conquering addiction class that goes on Monday evenings. And we bring in a guy to teach it, and he's named Tim Gray. He's a pastor from a church here in Arnold. And he put up this visual. There's this cross visual. And he says, when we first come to Jesus, like, our view of the cross is pretty small. And we believe that Jesus died for our sins, that he loves me, that he offers forgiveness and reconciliation with God. And that's huge, but all this stuff is new. And he says, but what we've got to do is we've got to dwell upon the cross. We've got to dwell upon Jesus. As Josh mentioned a couple weeks ago, everything we do has to be centered around Jesus. Centered around Jesus. We have to obsess over his message. We have to, like he said last week, we have to realize that he's Lord. That's why I mentioned all the animal kingdom, his great wisdom and strength and power and intellect. And we've got to bend our knee and say, God, I think you know what you're talking about when it comes to my life, how you made me. So we got to take ourselves off the throne, obsess over him, dwell on his good news, and see, as we think about the cross, as we think about Jesus, an amazing thing happens. The more we dwell upon Christ's sacrifice and what he's done for us, our sin awareness becomes bigger. I realize that I am a mess. I realize that on my own, I am hopeless, that I am a sinner that needs help, that needs a Savior. So it's not that I start pointing my fingers at other people. I realize that I need help. I am a massive sinner, and the problem is deeper than I would ever like to admit or ever thought that it could be. But that doesn't lead to condemnation. And it doesn't lead to this false guilt and sorrow. What it leads to is we understand, as our sin becomes bigger in our eyes, we also understand God's holiness. And again, the word holy means set apart. So we understand why God is God, what makes him God, his mercy, his love, his perfection, and all of those things put the proper emphasis where it should be. And that is on glory and honor and thankfulness to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. An amazing plan. An amazing plan. As the cross gets bigger, all the other things seem to fall in place. We don't obsess over our sin. We hand it over in gratitude to our King. And I want to end with this illustration that I read this week. Again, from the book that I mentioned earlier. And this is what the guy writes. He says, I want to start with a question. Do you think a fish would be happy on a sandy beach? Of course not, he says. The fish's gills would be slapping in and out like hands clapping, his body flopping end to end like a crazed acrobat. But he says, imagine if we give our fish friend $100,000 in cold, hard, tax-free cash. Do you think Mr. Fishy would be happy now? He says, can you picture him still flapping and flopping? But suppose we give him a cold Corona and a Playfish magazine. I didn't write this stuff. Again, Fishy wouldn't be happy. See, no matter what we give the fish on the beach, it won't satisfy him. There is nothing that could make the fish happy on the beach because he isn't made for the beach. The sand isn't his home. Anything apart from water will leave him wanting for the place for which he was created. And he says the same is true of us. Ultimately, we will not be happy with the things of this world because we are not made for this broken world. We are strangers, aliens, foreigners on earth. We are made to dwell forever with our Lord in heaven. We will never discover lasting happiness and satisfaction in the temporary things of this world because we weren't made to live a temporary life. That's why we should lower our expectations of this place. Earth is not heaven. It was never meant to be. That's why no amount of money, new house, new living room furniture, new kitchen appliances, new clothes, new hair, new baby, new vacation, new job, new income, new boyfriend or girlfriend, new spouse, or new anything will ever satisfy us because we are not made for the things of this world. And he goes on, he quotes Psalm 97:12 that says this, may all who are godly be happy in the Lord and praise his holy name. And he says, real happiness and satisfaction is found only in Jesus. And only in Jesus. And here's what I'd say. Don't buy into the worldliness that's around us. Keep this in mind. See, he's the living water that satisfies your thirst. He's the bread of life that brings complete sustenance. He is the well that never runs dry. He is the Prince of Peace. In him we find true rest. He is the way, the truth, and the life. And if you run after what the world offers and promises, here's the deal. You're going to settle for a cheap counterfeit. And it's not going to lead to abundant life. It's ultimately going to lead to death. All about Jesus. Let's go to God in prayer. Father in heaven, I thank you. I thank you for the fact that you love us so much, that you are for us so much, that you are not going to leave us as we are, that you want us to change, that you offer so much for us. And Father, we're weak on our own and we get picked off. And Father, it's easy for us to adapt to our culture and to try and fit in that. But Father, we know that only you bring true life, true abundance, true joy and peace. And Father, my prayer just to close this down is the same prayer that your apostle, that your servant Paul prayed for the Philippian church. And he says, and I say this over the people today and watching online in Oak Ridge City, but I pray that our love, God, may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight. That as we just are consumed with Jesus, we understand who he is more and more, what he's done for us, so that we're able to discern what is best. And God, that will keep us pure and righteous until the day that you decide to come back. Father, I thank you for your amazing grace. So often we get messed up, whether it's legalism, whether it's idolatry, whether it's just the worldliness around us. It's so easy for us to get deceived. And Father, we know that you're a loving parent. You're the loving Father that desires good for us. And Father, I just pray that we bend our knee to you, that this week we repent. We do a 180. We obsess over you and your things so that our mind is changed and we are changed from the inside out and our actions and attitudes begin to show that and reveal that. Thank you for your patience for us. Thank you for your forgiveness. And even though we go wayward, you don't give up on us. You keep calling us back in love to you. We are thankful that your kindness is what leads us to repentance. So Father, we give you all the glory and praise and honor in the mighty name of Jesus, our Savior and King. Amen. Let's stand up and sing.
Ground with grace, roll my
surrender, I need you now. Hold my heart now and forever, my soul cries out. Here I stand, I surrender, I need you now. Hold my heart now and forever, my soul cries out. Oh, here I stand, I surrender, I need you now. Hold my heart now and forever, my soul cries out. Here I stand, I surrender,
you're in Christ, you are healed and you are forgiven, and no matter who you are in the room, Jesus loves you to your core, but he doesn't necessarily agree with everything that you do or everything that I do, and that stuff needs to be surrendered. And so maybe you did it during that song, but I want to give all of us a moment before we head out of here. Maybe something that is not lined up with the will of God in our lives, and we know it. There's sin, there's worldliness that's creeped in some area of our lives. May we surrender that now together. Take a moment between you and God. Jesus, at the cross, you announced that our sin is dead, but today we acknowledge that for us as human beings, while we're on this side of heaven, it can still be deadly. It's powerful. So, Father, whatever it is in the room, lust, greed, anger, gluttony, the mistreating of our bodies, pride, essentially all of it is wrapped up in selfishness. Father, we surrender that to you. And God, we acknowledge that this isn't going to be a one-time thing and it's going to be taken care of tomorrow morning. We're going to have to wake up and we're going to have to surrender again. Before we go to bed tonight, we're going to have to surrender again. We're going to have to continually bend our knee to you. We're going to have to continually rely on your Spirit to help us. But Father, I pray that we can do that. Father, I pray that today we don't feel condemned. Father, I pray that we feel convicted. I pray that we don't enter into a sorrow that leads to death, but I pray that we can feel a godly sorrow that leads to repentance and change into the life that you've created us to live, because nothing else satisfies. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Hey, thanks for being here. I promise, real quick, come back next time my dad preaches. I'm going to have him wear the same shirt, only I'm going to get him some new jeans. There are going to be some rips in it. It's going to look really, really good. Hey, we hope to see you back next week. We love you. Have a good week.